guidance expressly prohibited federal agents from using race as a factor in their investigations unless they encountered specific, credible information that made race relevant to a particular case. But it did not prohibit the consideration of such factors as national origin, religion, gender, or sexual orientation. And it broadly exempted investigations and operations that implicated America's national security. An unduly, I believe, expansive exemption that was the subject of legitimate criticism. As Attorney General, I have repeatedly made clear that racial profiling by law enforcement is not only wrong, it's misguided, and it is ineffective because it can mistakenly guide and focus investigative efforts, waste precious resources, and ultimately undermine public trust in what it is that we do. Now, like some of you, this is something that I experienced personally, a younger man, in a very deeply personal way. I'll never forget the frustration I felt of being pulled over twice in my car search on the New Jersey Turnpike, even though I'm sure I wasn't speeding. A 1971 Plymouth Duster. I love that car. I'll never forget the humiliation of being stopped by a police officer who simply saw me running and catch a move at night in Georgetown, Washington, D.C. It's a nice part of Washington, D.C. and stopped and asked me, what was I doing? Where was I going? At the time of that stop, I was a federal prosecutor. A lot younger than I am now. Hair was a little darker. But I was working on a thing called the Public Integrity Section of the Criminal Division of the United States Department of Justice. The police officer, I was just a black guy, in the wrong place, running fast at night, and he thought it was a basis to stop me. Now, these experiences bear out what research has consistently found, that when those who come in contact with law enforcement feel they have been treated fairly, and that official actions are both appropriate and warranted, they are more likely to accept decisions by the authorities. People are more likely to obey the law, and people are more likely to cooperate with law enforcement in the future, even if they disagree with specific outcomes. Now, this is especially true in communities where crime challenges are at their most acute, and where interactions with police officers are too often characterized by discord and by distress. And that's why I think it's incumbent upon Justice Department leaders and others in law enforcement at every level to help bridge this divide. Because trust in the system and compliance with the law must begin not with the fear of arrest or even the threat of incarceration, but with respect for the institutions that guide our democracy and for the laws, policies, and the courageous men and women who keep us safe. Over the past 5 years, we have scrupulously looked at those 2003 guidelines with an eye towards ensuring that all federal agents can fulfill their core law enforcement, public safety, and national security responsibilities with maximum legitimacy, accountability, and transparency. I'm here to report that this review has reached its conclusion. And we have determined that although the Department's 2003 use of race guidance prohibited racial profiling in a really broad sense, it's time to do even more. It's time to expand upon the safeguards that are currently in place. It's time to institute new protections for those who come in contact with federal authorities. And it's time to bring enhanced training, oversight, and accountability to this process so that anyone responsible for isolated incidents of profiling can be held responsible and singular acts of discrimination do not tarnish the exemplary work that's performed by the overwhelming majority of America's federal law enforcement officials each and every day. And particularly in light of the recent incidents that we've seen at the local level and the widespread concerns about trust in the criminal justice process that so many have raised and continue to raise throughout our nation, it's imperative that we take every possible action to ensure strong and sound policing practices. We must instill the absolute highest standards of professionalism as well as integrity. And that's why yesterday I announced new guidance that will supersede the directive that was issued in 2003. And it will apply to all federal law enforcement agents conducting law enforcement activities, including when those activities relate to national security as well as intelligence. Now, this new guidance will expand prohibited profiling criteria by explicitly banning profiling based not only on race, but also for the very first time on gender. national origin, religion, sexual orientation, gender identity. It will apply the same uniform standard to all investigations, national security operations, and intelligence activities conducted by federal law enforcement. It will govern the actions of every single FBI, DEA, and ATF agent, every United States Marshal, and every other federal law enforcement agent conducting law enforcement activities, including state and local law enforcement officers assigned to federal task forces. And it will include training, oversight, and accountability measures to ensure that all federal law enforcement activities and operations reflect our commitment to keeping the nation safe while upholding our most sacred values and the rights of all communities and individuals. Now, this constitutes a major and important step forward to ensure effective policing by federal authorities throughout the nation. It will institutionalize clear and critical strategies that are already in place in the field and are currently enabling us to protect the safety of our nation and maintain the trust of our citizens. And it codifies positive policies and practices that are now being observed by the FBI, the ATF, the DEA, and the United States Marshal Service. Today, I urge state and local law enforcement agencies to look to this new federal guidance as a model and to develop their own rigorous policies along similar lines. This will promote sound law enforcement techniques that will help to move us toward the ultimate goal of ending racial profiling once and for all. And it will enable every American to have greater confidence in the mechanisms in place to hold their government accountable, to work in concert with law enforcement to secure their communities, and to make public safety not only an obligation for those who are sworn to serve, but a promise that's fulfilled by citizens and public servants side by side. Throughout the country, my colleagues and I are taking meaningful steps to make good on this promise and to expand our ability to protect and to empower all of our citizens. In meetings with law enforcement and community leaders, like the ones I've convened in Atlanta, Cleveland, as I said, soon here in Memphis, we're opening new lines of communication and cooperation through the efforts of the Justice Department's Civil Rights Division, which has opened more than 20 investigations into public police departments across the country in the last 5 fiscal years. We're striving to correct unconstitutional policing practices. In conjunction with the President's recent policy announcements, reforming the way the federal government equips state and local law enforcement, particularly with regard to military-style equipment, investing in the use of body cameras and promoting clean community policing initiatives, and engaging law enforcement and community leaders to reduce crime while building public trust. I'm confident that all of these efforts will help to move us forward, and I can think of no better place to renew our shared commitment to this work than right here in Memphis. Following today's summit, I'll visit the National Civil Rights Museum at the LA Hotel. And Dr. King's room is preserved just as it was on the night that he lost his life. He knew when he arrived there, April 3rd, 1968, that threats had been made against him. He spoke frankly about these threats and about his own mortality in the Mason Temple speech that was to be his last. He acknowledged that at the age of just 39, think about that, 39 years of age, he acknowledged at that tender young age that his life might soon come to a violent end. His optimism did not waver. His dedication to nonviolence and his adherence to non-aggression did not wane. But his unshakable belief in the divine and the promise of what this nation could become, and especially when his fellow citizens remained stronger than ever. Dr. King believed, as we believe, in the need for mutual respect and the power of nonviolent collective action. He recognized that nonviolence is the single best path to bring about enduring change. Enduring change. He once wrote that promoting nonviolence in law is the only way, quote, to cut off the chain of hate. And he called us all to remember that, and I quote him again, that the aftermath of nonviolence is the creation of the beloved community, while the aftermath of violence is tragic bitterness. Today, in this moment of challenge, take far too much bitterness. Let us reclaim these timeless principles. In this age of